Hello, everybody. Welcome to our first Papers We Love of 2016. Woo! Yes, we like to woo. Do you have anything to announce?
Ooh, it's the first one of the year. We're at Heroku for the first one. Next month is TBA right now as to location. We will let you know soon. And we're really excited for the year to start. Not many new surprises yet. We're going to continue doing the minis this year, which is great. So if you are interested in giving a talk and you're not sure about the topic, or you've never really done a lot of public speaking, or you want to dip your toe into the pool of public speaking, the mini might be right for you. Yeah. When is the next mini available?
I think May or June. So, yeah, so you have time to prep. It could be future you problem. And I do have a lot of the speakers lined up for this year, and I've been really neglectful on about putting up the events. So I will fix this weekend. So stay tuned. We have really excellent speakers. And we're going to get it started then. So normally, for those of you who are new, I see a few new faces. Who's new? Oh, wow. Oh, wow. All right, so what happens is, like, normally, like, I get a bio from the speaker, and then I tell it to you, and I add something fake. So this is going to be, like, how we introduce our first speaker. His name is Bryan, and what you need to know about Bryan is that he hacks distributed systems by day and does almost anything else by night. His interest in percussion and computers began nearly coincidentally over 20 years ago in a small town on the Great Plains. The combination has led to him having strange thoughts about time and coordination. He has also successfully baked 3 Teletubby cakes. So let's give it up for Bryan.
Is this thing on? Oh, cool. There it goes. Ta-da. I'll put this over here. So we have to get the slides up. I guess we'll use... Hopefully this stays in place, kind of. No SSD in this one. There we go. That's it. Did I type that right? There. PWL, drum, segmentation. No. Sweet. So, I am going to talk about one of those other things tonight, not distributed systems, because I couldn't think of anything I wanted to talk about in 10 minutes that hasn't already been talked about before. We're going to talk about a paper tonight called Fluctuations of Hi-Hat Timing and Dynamics in a Virtuoso Drum Track of a Popular Music Recording. I came in contact with this paper because I'm a drummer. And browsing Reddit one day, I found there was a professor in the UK at the University of Nottingham who was going to teach a class or do a project, not clear, to some students based on this paper. They are going to do basically the same analysis that is done in this paper, but on a different set of recordings. So this paper does it on a professional recording of a virtuoso drummer. They're going to gather a whole bunch of amateurs playing another song and see if the same patterns emerge from amateurs. I found this paper interesting because I've always wanted to know more about time series analysis. I've helped build a few systems that help people do it, but never really done it myself. So in the process of reading this paper, I decided it would be fun to basically replicate what they did with their data set in an IPython notebook. I don't have a MATLAB license like they do. I imagine most of you don't either. So I've put this notebook up on the web. So if you want to go check out how to do this yourself, you can later. There's a link at the bottom. But let's just get started. So the piece of music we're looking at, and they looked at in the paper, is called I Keep Forgetting by Michael McDonald. It's recorded in 1982. Not really my favorite song, but not really, you know, my choice. There are 3 interesting things about this song and the reason they chose it. The first is that it's drummed by a guy named Jeff Porcaro. Jeff Porcaro is possibly the most recorded musician of the 70s and 80s, at least in the, you know, pop general genre. He played with everyone, from Boz Scaggs to Warren Zevon. He was the drummer on Thriller, Michael Jackson's hit, and lots of other things. So 1982, he's top of his game. He is absolutely a virtuoso drummer. And this was important because they want someone that is actually skilled. The second interesting part about this song is, as you can see from the score, if you're a drummer or a flautist, you know that the top line is basically the hi-hat. This is when the drummer should be hitting this little cymbal next to him to kind of keep time for the band. You can see that it's all 16th notes. So this is played pretty fast. It's a 100 beat per minute song, which is not that fast, but he plays four times per beat. So most drummers would take this and play it two-handed, some sort of alternating, maybe straight alternating, maybe paradiddles, but they'd use two hands. Jeff Porcaro plays this with one hand. So he's going twice the speed, but just using one hand. They thought this would be more interesting for the analysis because then you're not trying to figure out how he's coordinating two hands. It's just this twitch. So there's that. And the third interesting thing about this song is that it was recorded without using a metronome. So most musicians, when they record something, they'll have a little thing in their ear that's ticking along with the beat. So they can kind of self-correct to make sure they're playing on beat. This was recorded without a metronome because Jeff Porcaro, again, is a virtuoso drummer, can basically keep himself on the beat and prove this to many recording engineers. So they were cool with him doing this. So what they wanted to check in this analysis that described in the paper was basically how well he does stay on beat. You know, is he always exactly on the beat? Does he vary a little bit? Is he way off? All that kind of stuff. So I am not going to do the first part of their paper, which is basically where they extracted his beats from the recorded music. This was back before we were doing digital recording. He was playing live drums. So they just have an audio recording. And they had to do things that actually look a lot like log analysis that probably all of you have done with your software. You know, they kind of looked at the recording broken down by frequency and found interesting points. Those things all the way up the top are what are likely the hi-hat hits. It's a very high frequency. It's kind of tss. So they would find an interesting spot and then work backwards from there to find out where he actually hit the cymbal. And they ended up with lots of, you know, dirty parts in the data where they thought maybe they could find a hit, but they couldn't find the onset because it was too noisy, kind of like when your logs are too noisy and they start dropping messages. But anyway, they got through all this and published their data set from the from what they pulled out of the song. So I'm going to start from there and work on from what they learned from there. So very simple analysis you can do. Their data set is basically the time that Jeff hit the cymbal. They also recorded the amplitude. I'm not going to talk about the amplitude tonight, but if you're interested in it, they do basically the exact same analysis on the amplitude, so you could use this as a way to go learn it yourself. They're not so much interested directly in the time of the onset as the time between the onsets. So they do a simple subtraction of one onset from the next. And then the basic first plot you can do is just line graph of when the onsets, what the intervals were between them. You can see, you know, it kind of hovers around an average, has some outliers, that kind of thing. You can even plot this as a histogram, and you can see, again, you got this nice Gaussian curve, which they do actually, you know, do the proper test to figure out it is basically Gaussian in the paper. But their more interesting analysis starts when they talk about drift. You know, how far off the beat does Jeff get? So in order to do this, you have to figure out when the clicks should have been if he was playing with a metronome. And because there was no metronome going, they don't know exactly when they should have been, so they do kind of a backwards analysis. They figure out about what his average click rate was, and then figure out from there where the clicks should have been in those gaps, and figure out when, if he was playing at an exactly constant rate, when those onsets would have been. So by comparing the expected onset to the observed onset, you can actually find out how far off Jeff was from his playing. And you can see in this graph, basically zero. The lines don't show up because, I don't know, Chrome maybe, I don't know. Zero is basically exactly on target. He would be exactly on the beat. Anything above is faster. Anything below is slower. So you can see, as the song progresses, the x-axis is the number of the hit on the cymbal. You can see as the song progresses, he actually slows down a ways and then speeds up. This is actually not slowed down, but it's just behind. He gets down to this slow part by just hitting a little bit behind the metronome each time. This is 200 clicks, which is about 50 seconds. He gets behind 300 milliseconds. The song's about 100 beats per minute, so each click should be about 150 milliseconds. So by 50 seconds into the song, he's two clicks behind, an eighth note. If the rest of the band were following the interval, he would be playing the offbeat. He's that far behind. But doing that over 50 seconds means he lost like a millisecond for each hit on the cymbal. So 1 millisecond out of 150 is not bad. In fact, the human ear would never hear it. None of the musicians heard it. They all think he's exactly on beat. The second interesting thing about this graph is that you see it dives and then it comes back up. The places where it changes direction basically align with the parts of the song. So this first dive is the intro and then the first verse. He comes back up on the chorus, back down on the next verse, back up on the chorus, down on a kind of intro interlude part, and then actually makes it back to exactly on the metronome for the outro. So kind of cool, right? Well, the next thing they do is what they were actually looking for in the paper. So what they're trying to figure out is if there's a pattern to this noise. We know that there is noise, we know that he drifted, but is there a pattern to it, or is it just completely random? So in order to figure this out, they do what they call detrended fluctuation analysis. We're analyzing the fluctuations. Detrending is just finding a regression and finding out how well it fits the data. You do that by subtracting the regression from the data, detrending, subtracting the trend, and then computing how well it fits by computing basically the root mean square of that data set. So they do this over a variety of window sizes. So they start with basically, you know, 6 onsets, basically a beat and a half. And they do that for the whole song, all the windows, 6.5 beats. Then they go back and they do 7 beats, 8 beats, all the way up to 200 hits, 200 onsets, which is basically a full section of the song, you know, that intro plus the first verse. And by doing this, they figure out how well each of those windows can be fit to the data in that window. So basically, you make a plot that is the window size and the fit. And you can see it kind of has this logarithmic curve to it. So if we plot it on a log-log graph instead, it kind of straightens out. But if we try to fit that whole data set, what we find is that there's a knee kind of right around 30 to 50 onsets. 32 onsets is 2 measures. 64 onsets is 4 measures, what we would normally call a phrase. So there's some difference between anything up to 2 measures and anything larger than a phrase. So what they did in the paper was they fit these independently. So you get a fit of the small windows and a fit of the large windows. And you can see that they both fit really well. This is pretty cool because the fit on the large window, they're trying to fit to a function that is basically just a simple exponent. It's the size of the window taken to some number. The number they found that fit is 0.72 for the large windows. This means that it is not white noise. If it were white noise, it would be 0.5. So anything above white noise up to about 1.5 is in kind of what they call the pink noise regime. And that means that it's very likely that each onset will be very close to the expected onset with a long tail, this, you know, logarithmic kind of long tail thing. And that's cool because it also means that the noise has a long range correlation. So the noise through the whole segment of the song relates to the entire history of that segment. It's not random, it's correlated very well. So that's cool. That's actually one of the main findings of the paper. Earlier papers had focused on playing along with a metronome. This is without a metronome. So it's interesting to find that there is this pink noise. There's pink noise in other sort of human actions and muscle actions especially. So finding it here in a virtuoso's muscle contractions is kind of interesting. Below that, in the smaller size, I found a correlation that the exponent was 0.44. I think I must have had some thing slightly off because they found 0.31. That's actually moving into the anti-correlation space. So still not white noise, but negatively correlated. And if you go down to the smallest window possible, just one beat to the next, you can plot this thing called a return time. And basically, on the x-axis, you have interval n. On the y-axis, you have n plus 1. So you're just comparing, you know, this beat to the next beat. And you can see, really obviously, this negative trend. And it just means that if he's a little bit long on this hit, he'll be a little bit short on the next hit. And that's basically how he stays on the tempo. What's interesting about this is that he's not playing with a metronome, but earlier papers that studied people playing with a metronome had this exact same shape. This is how someone syncs with a metronome. So it basically shows that Jeff was somehow syncing with some internal metronome. This is also how two players sync to each other. If they're both trying to match speeds, they will both have this kind of jiggling. So it's pretty cool. At the small scale, you get this anti-correlation. At large scale, you get pink noise. And that's basically all I have, because basically what is left over to figure out is whether or not this pink noise is interesting, whether it contributes to the groove or the feel of the song. There's been a little bit of study that people generally prefer pink noise to either, you know, complete machine or white noise. Just the ear likes the feel of it a little better. But there has not been study into whether pink noise plays into the groove, you know, whether people like to dance to it or not. So that's still outstanding. And as I said, someone else is doing a study to figure out whether amateurs have this same variety, whether different amateurs have different varieties, that kind of thing. So that's all I have. Like I said, this is up on a webpage. I'll tweet a link to this real quick. And this is an IPython notebook, the notebook I've tarred up. So you can actually download this. There's a nice thing that you can just run on your computer. And then all of these things I did above end up in a nice interactive environment. So you can just rerun, replot all the time. It's a really slick system and really helped me learn how to do this. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions. Oh, anybody has any questions? No? Can you play the song?
I don't think I can, actually. I don't actually own the song. I am not a Michael McDonald fan. I could rap out the rhythm for you on the table, but I would hope you don't make me do that.
So has this proven like virtuosos are like as good as it's going to get? It's like you can't get better than this, or has anybody been better under this analysis? I mean, synthetic.
This is brand new. This just came out this fall. So I think they're still studying. I'm not sure.
So are we just going to start looking at music in this type of analysis, or it's just like it's a little crazy?
It's a little crazy. I mean, it's one of those things that, one of the interesting things about this is trying to figure out in the world of machine-generated music, should we be adding some sort of pink noise to make it sound better, that kind of thing.
Somebody have the song over there? Okay, I can give you a microphone if you want to for a little bit. Who has it?
I have it right here.
Okay.
There you go. So you can see it. So hear that real high.
And we're going to get blocked from YouTube. Yes, he's saying that it's 30 seconds and we can go back to it. Well, very nice.
The follow-on study is not using this. It's using Rush's Tom Sawyer. Much more interesting song. And I mean, that's Neil Peart, so how can you get better than that?
All right, if nobody has a question, let's give it up for Bryan. He has a full-length talk in September. Yes. So he's coming back for a full-length talk. So if anybody wants to reshuffle or like take some of the empty seats, now is the time to do it. I see you, Justin. You can go. And let's get set up for, let's just get this Basho thing. There we go. We put it out of his misery. I meant it very nicely. Slideshow. Yeah, let's do this for you. Oh.
I spoiled the surprise.
No. All right. There we go. Okay. There we go.
Did that work? We'll see. Well, I'm gonna see if this keeps advancing.
I think it's good.
Okay, we're good. All right.
All right. So while he's getting mic'd, I'm going to introduce him. So Henry is an engineer at Cloudera, where he has worked for 5 years on a wide variety of distributed systems. He currently works full-time on Impala, an SQL query engine for data stored in HDFS. Before Cloudera, he worked on ad hoc networking at Cambridge University, where he also won the National Fancy Beer Contest in 2007. He writes infrequently about databases and distributed systems at thepapertrail.org. So let's give it up for Henry.
Hello, can you hear me? Everything good? All right, good. Actually, there were two falsehoods in your introduction. It's been 2 years since I sent you that, so I've now been at Cloudera for all of 7 years, and boy, am I tired. Thank you, everybody, for coming to Papers We Love tonight. It's a real pleasure to be speaking here for the second time. I think it's appropriate to thank everyone who works like really hard to make these meetups happen. It's obviously not didn't just happen by accident, particularly Elaine and Ina seem to put in a huge amount of effort. So I think that's appropriate. It's also super kind of Heroku to host us in this beautiful, diffuse-lit auditorium on those very comfortable seats. If you want to stretch out, relax a little bit, I won't be offended. As my introduction said, my name's Henry Robinson. I'm going to be using my English accent to lull you into a false sense of my own competency over the next 40 minutes or so. As you heard, I work at Cloudera on Impala, which is a SQL query engine, and that's going to be the beginning and end of my pitch. If you're interested in working on that kind of stuff, please come and talk to me. The paper I'm going to talk about today is this one. It's a long title, No Compromises, Distributed Transactions with Consistency, Availability, and High Performance. Now, before we go any further, I want to own up to something about this paper. It's not necessarily yet a paper I love. In fact, we've only been seeing each other for a little while. But it's going pretty well, and today I'd like you guys to meet each other, kind of bring it home to the family, so to speak. And so I guess the first question is, how did we meet? And if I can, let me see if this works. How do I actually advance? Do I press the right button?
There's a keyboard at the bottom.
Oh, and now my mic's falling off. Okay, well, I hope you all enjoy that.
That's it. I'm off. It's terrific. This is being recorded as well. That's a real proud moment.
Okay.
Even better.
Beep.
Okay. All right. Okay. So yeah. Right. So today, this is the mandatory what we're going to talk about slide. I'll actually come back to this. I want to talk about how I wound up. This is extraordinarily awkward. I have tiny ears. Let's try that. And I'll just keep my head on the side like that. And if that unnerves any of you, well. That might actually be better, yeah. It's just going to be bothering me otherwise.
Hello?
Yeah.
Hello? Much better. OK, terrific. Tiny ears. Right. So how do we get into this paper? Well, in early December, Ines was gently, kindly, as is her boy, bugging me every day to let her know what paper I was going to present. And, well, I just had my second kid, or really technically my wife had just had my second kid, and I'd read nothing more challenging than like a Where's Maisie book, which is terrific, by the way, in months. So I cast around on Twitter for a good suggestion. Oops, I'm pressing the wrong keyboard. And here's what happens. So I asked Twitter, what should I read? I don't have any really good ideas. And I got this response from Andy Pavlo. Now, I don't know how many of you are familiar with Andy Pavlo, but he's one of those genuinely brilliant database professors, kind of in the Peter Baylor's mold. He's at CMU, I think, now. In his PhD work, he worked on a system called HStore, which is tremendously influential. And so when he suggests a paper, I take it to heart. So I read it and thought it was a really cool paper. Then I remember that the last time I saw Professor Pavlo, he was giving a talk at Cloudera, and he wasn't wearing pants. So maybe my judgment is off. But no other papers were springing to mind, so we'll go ahead with this one. Let's start talking about fun. So, like I said, it's a paper I like, a paper I'm growing exceptionally fond of. And here's what I think I will wind up loving about it. Here's what I think are some of its real strengths. And the first thing, can I pull this out? No, I should just stop touching things. The first thing I think is terrific is that, who's read the paper, by the way? I'd say about maybe 20%, 30%. Okay, you guys can go, that's fine. The rest of you I'm going to lie to. The first thing I think is terrific about this paper, which introduces really just a way to build a distributed database that's extremely efficient. That's the one-line summary. It challenges an existing orthodoxy without being a polemic. So all of you, I'm sure, have been completely aware of the hand-wringing over cap theorems and pack elk. I don't know how you even say it. Can we have high performance if we have strong consistency guarantees? And no, we can't, and it's all terrible, and we should just keep building NoSQL stores until we're all dead. This paper acts as kind of like a constructive refutation of those kind of like doom and gloom scenarios. It actually produces a system that has really terrific performance and correctness guarantees, has extremely good availability properties, and it does so without getting on its soapbox, but actually just tells you, look, here's the system, here's how we build it. I like that. The theories that I referred to earlier, they kind of, they set the boundaries for system design, but they leave a great unexplored space in between, and I think it's best as a group of researchers and implementers that we just get on with our lives and start exploring that space. And what they've done here, I think, is a really interesting data point. The second thing, just juggling two computers here, because one's not enough, so I have some notes which I'm reading from. The other thing I like about it is that it manages this tricky thing for systems papers to do, which is to be forward-looking, anticipate changes without being like massively blue sky. So much work you read is like just tiny and incremental. Hey, we managed to make a Byzantine fault tolerance protocol ever so slightly faster, which is great, except no one uses Byzantine fault tolerance protocols. And what's much more interesting to me is to say, look, what's coming down the pipe? How are our systems going to have to adapt to this? But also to keep it like reasonably current, so it's not something we're going to have to worry about in 10 years, when obviously like your error rate goes up because you're looking so much further into the future. The third thing I love about it is it's an SOSP paper, and I don't know how many of you read like the Symposium on Operating Systems Principles regularly. Maybe I should try reading that to my kid. That might actually put him to sleep. But the great thing about these papers is they're usually terrifically dense, they're engineering heavy, they built the systems. And this paper is no exception. They go out, they have these ideas, and then they actually build a system that's not just a trivial prototype, but they actually run into a bunch of problems and say, okay, here's how we worked around these performance difficulties with using RDMA, or here's how we dealt with the fact that actually we can't use CPU on a particular part of the Paxos protocol. And I admire those papers terrifically because I have seen firsthand the amount of work that has to go into them and the high bar that they have to jump over to get into a conference like SOSP. So I'm a fan. So let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. I'm kind of singing its praises without telling you too much about it. This, if I was going to really summarize the paper in one pithy line, I would say it's about whether or not we need to compromise. And I've alluded to this a little bit already. The question is, how much do we have to give up, given hardware trends in the future of consistency, availability, high performance, and so on? Of course, fundamentally, we have to compromise. We all know that. But if we just move beyond that, as I was trying to suggest we should, this paper kind of asks the question of like, okay, so when the characteristics of hardware change, when memory maybe gets a bit more durable, or when the network actually stops being a bottleneck, what do we redesign? What do we change? What do we have to compromise? And the answer is, to me, actually kind of interesting. So I think it's interesting maybe to, in a very reductive sense, present this paper in the context of the lineage of database systems research. And this is extraordinarily reductive. It misses out thousands, probably, of relevant papers. But you can draw kind of a narrative thread from maybe the early 80s when people started really building these systems in earnest. So the first thing we did, I say we, the database researchers of the time did, was notice that in the 1980s, disks are really slow, memory is really small. So there's the bottleneck. We have to go to disk a lot. So let's invent an algorithm like Grace Hash Join and its friends, which allow us to make efficient use of external memory. There's a reference here for people who may not be as familiar with the database literature. And let's do our very best to shift the bottleneck away from the disk, or at least mitigate the problem. In the 1990s, this was kind of the first attempt to build real distributed databases. And distributed in that sense, in that time, maybe meant something a little different to how we interpret it now. It was very, very focused on the idea of cross-site, wide-area network-based distributed databases. And there was a system called Mariposa at the time that was attempting to address the bottleneck that now networks were imposing upon these database systems. So, a lot of research was done. We built like a cross-site optimizer that takes into account where the data is, moves the computation to the data. Hey, that sounds familiar. Again, mitigates a bottleneck. The bottleneck is shifting as the designs and the hardware trends are moving. In the 2000s, actually memory got really slow for a certain class of workloads. When you have sufficiently small data to run your workload roughly in memory, and that's true of like transactional processing systems a lot of the time, it turns out that memory is actually the bottleneck. So what do we do? Well, there was this terrific line of research from the people who have gone on to found a company called Snowflake to build extremely cache and memory efficient operator implementations like joins. And I think that's a really interesting paper, and it really informs some of the work we did in Impala. Around 2010, maybe a little bit earlier, but I'm sticking with the one thing per per decade narrative, disks got really slow again. We've got lots and lots and lots of computers. We've got lots and lots and lots of data. We have big data, and we store, we can't store the working set completely in memory, so we have to read it off disk. So what do? Oh, well, we shove a ton of them in a single box. Sometimes the research isn't quite so clever. And this was just like, let's load up on disks. And that actually worked reasonably well. So simplifying a great deal and doing a ton of people a huge disservice. Currently, the bottleneck for, missed my notes. Simplifying a great deal, database system design over the course of the last, say, 30 to 40 years, can be viewed as an exercise in like chasing a moving target. The bottleneck shifts. The relative speeds of CPU and disk and memory change. Then all of your design assumptions change, and you often have to go back to the whiteboard. The probably the central thesis of this paper is that we're approaching another one of those inflection points. And we'll talk about why as I go through the slides. But that means that we have to do not exactly a clean slate re-examination of how we build distributed databases, but we have to at least re-examine our fundamental assumptions. In 2015, the hypothesis is that we're going back to CPUs being relatively slow, which is weird because CPUs going to keep getting faster, right? So what's the trend that's like shifting the bottleneck? The paper is about what we do about it. So why do they think CPUs are going to be slow? Well, they think they observe two hardware trends that are going to shift the bottleneck. We're going to have non-volatile storage that's extremely quick. Now, non-volatile storage is extremely important in databases for recovering from system-wide power outages. It effectively provides durability, and it's the only way we really know how to do that. Also, message latency, i.e. the cost of communicating between computers, is going to decrease. Why are these things? Oh, and I should point out that this is not kind of speculative, high-end, extremely expensive technology. The paper says, look, this is actually going to be cheap. Data centers are expensive, and the marginal cost of adding this technology to your computers is going to be affordable. We're going to see systems that can take advantage. We're going to see deployments that have these characteristics in the near future. So what's leading us towards these things? So for non-volatile storage, the first of the two trends, you may have heard of kind of non-volatile DRAM and thought, you know, heard that's, you know, incredibly expensive, or like PCIe attached flash storage that's addressable like memory. And again, you know, it's very expensive. And this is such a great idea. And I'm not a hardware guy, so this may have been around since ever, but it just seems like a great hack. You just attach a UPS to your memory. And then when the power is out, instead of the memory like wiping itself, it's got like a death rattle. You know, it's got its last wishes, and its last wishes are to write itself to the attached SSD, which is also powered by the UPS. So as long as you have sufficient capacity on your attached SSD, you're faking durability of your DRAM. This is very, very cool, because it means that you effectively get non-volatile RAM, RAM that doesn't wipe itself over after a power reset, for free in terms of performance. What you pay for is in the energy it costs to power the UPS. Also, I suppose it adds a tiny bit of overhead to restarts, but who really cares about that, because they're extremely expensive anyway. Moving on to low latency data center messaging. So typical data centers right now still use TCP/IP as their transport protocol. There's a lot of interesting research in making TCP/IP for the data center. But again, TCP/IP comes built with a lot of assumptions and a lot of mechanisms that aren't necessarily super important for a data center network, where the distances are more different, the administration domains are typically all within your control, you don't have to cope with such variability in traffic and so on and so forth. You have a lot more, it's a lot more knowable, a lot more understandable as a network, so maybe we should use something a little more optimal. And so, this protocol called, this kind of suite of protocols called RDMA, which stands for Remote Direct Memory Access, just allows you kind of effectively to reach out and touch someone. You can say to some other machine in the cluster, I want to look at your memory. I want to inspect, you know, bytes 10 through 20 of some memory region that you're exposing. And you can do that without involving the CPU at all. So this is really tremendously efficient. Absolutely cuts down on the time it takes to communicate between machines. And that, again, shifts our assumptions about what is expensive and what isn't expensive when we're designing distributed protocols. Again, the hardware trend that's driving this is, originally Oracle, RAC, and so on and so forth, they have InfiniBand, which is, you know, a very expensive, high-quality implementation of RDMA. But it turns out that, as is so often the case, market forces cause a cheaper version to arise, and now we can do RDMA over converged Ethernet. That's the ROCE that I refer to here. And that allows you, with your existing hardware, to build RDMA-based applications. You just have to, I'm not a level one or two guy, but I understand you just have to really reconfigure some switches and make sure your switches have certain features, and then all of a sudden you can do RDMA between the machines in your cluster. So again, this is becoming practical at relatively small marginal costs. So in the context of distributed databases, and I'm sorry that slide is shouting at you quite as loudly as it is, what does this mean when we're actually thinking about how we build a distributed database? Well, one of the requirements of a distributed database, the D in ACID, is this thing called durability. And I think of durability best as the ability to survive a total power outage, a total kind of system restart. Because otherwise, you can start to fake durability with things like, well, I've got replicas, so if one machine restarts, I can recover the data from another replica. That's, to me, that's fault tolerance. I don't count that in durability. What I mean is durability is, if someone accidentally pulls the plug on my rack, will I get the data back? If you don't write to non-volatile storage, we know of no way to, physics knows of no way to make this work. So non-volatile storage is extremely interesting to us, and making it cheap and
to write to is very interesting. Messaging is typically extremely expensive. The cost of sending an RPC between machines in data center contexts is really, very, very non-zero. And I want to kind of dive into that assertion a little bit. So here is a super simplified version of what happens when you send an RPC and it's received on the sender. The sender has to fire an interrupt, the kernel has to come into play, the memory gets copied off of the NIC into the kernel, and forgive me if I'm slightly bastardizing this, if you're a kernel developer, you can come up and correct me with a stern wag of your finger after the fact. When the user space threads run, you've got to copy from the kernel memory into user space, and the handler thread has to run. You have to deserialize the message, and then you have to do something with it. Okay, so this all sounds terribly expensive, and this is why we have CPUs, but do we really want to spend it doing all of this? And in particular, this deserialization cost is extremely high, and I say that with data to back it up. This is a really, really interesting paper called Profiling a Warehouse Scale Computer. And basically what these guys did was they went and attached a bunch of profilers to Google. They said, look, can I have one of your data centers? And Google says, oh yeah, we've got thousands of these things. You pick one you like. And they attached a profiler, and half the paper is explaining how they did it in such a way to not actually hugely interfere with Google's money-making business. But they discovered kind of the existence of what's called a data center tax, which is, they say, kind of the cost of doing business on data center workloads. And it's high. Now, here you've got 25% of your cycles are spent in this tax code. It's 25%. Think what you could do if you could save Google 25% of its CPU costs. They would pay you enough for you to never ever think about computers ever again. But the lines that we're particularly interested in here are the kind of brownie one and the ochre one below it, where it says RPC and protobuf. Protobuf here, as I'm sure you guys know, protobuf is how Google does serialization. They've spent a lot of time on optimizing it. It's a very efficient format, but it has a cost to turn messages into things that I can use in memory from things that go on the wire. I might assert this kind of fundamentally due to the mapping between an address space, which can have relative offsets and so on and so forth, can basically have pointers, and something which needs to be self-contained, but that probably needs a little bit more thought. That was an off-the-cuff assertion. But you can see that we're spending, November in year one, whenever year one was, about 10% of the cycles in both performing the act of an RPC and doing some deserialization. This is a non-trivial cost. And so if we can do something about it, not only are we going to save ourselves money because we need fewer CPUs, but we're also maybe going to get higher performance out of our systems because if we keep the number of CPUs constant, well, we've got more CPU available to burn to do things like actual useful work. So this is why I think this paper might turn out to be extremely influential if the hardware trends run the same way. When we do RDMA, I just want to kind of highlight where the savings come from. There's typically no CPU engaged on either the read or the write path, on the typical read or write path. The way that this is done, so RDMA says on every machine that exposes an RDMA interface, register the regions of memory that you would like to expose, that you would like to make available. And what happens is that those are pinned in memory, so those are never going to get paged out. And the NIC itself, the network card, maintains a set of page tables itself. So really, it's just hardware offloading of stuff that the CPU do itself, but for a very specialized purpose, I suppose. So when a request comes in, the page tables are accessed. There's no actual paging. This is not full-fledged virtual memory. It can't go, like I said, the stuff is pinned into memory. There's no kind of extremely large address space. It's it's limited by the amount of physical memory that you actually have. But then you can reach out and access that memory directly. And it's not excluded from the CPU either. So the CPU can also access the memory, and this is, this interaction is mediated by the hardware. When FARM, and I'll talk a little bit more about FARM in general in a few slides,
But I just wanted to note here that there were two data structures identified by the paper. There's a transactional log, which is really just, you know, an append-only list of things that the database has done. Those are very common data structures. If you read the Kafka stuff, they would have you believe that everything in the world is a log. And then the other thing that's attached is a ring buffer, which is not a log. So, yeah. I'm doing them a great disservice. The messaging ring buffer is where you put in, you know, things for the CPU to actually pay attention to. But interacting with that ring buffer itself doesn't involve the CPU, but the CPU will, actions, more heavyweight operations from this ring buffer. But the really cool thing is that interacting with these things, you can just treat a remote machine's memory as an extension of your own. And I think that's super cool. So let's now, after that extensive introduction, let's talk a little bit about FARM. Now, at this point, actually, maybe I really want to skip back to the one I'm going to talk about slide, which don't worry, you won't have to see Andy Pavlo again. I want to give an overview of FARM, and I think I've hopefully covered the technological context. One thing I want to mention is the last time I gave a talk at Papers We Love, I talked about FLP, which was just a trudge through a very long and complicated proof. And people were, passing out during the talk, and it was an ugly scene. So I'm skipping over all proofs this time. There are proofs of correctness in the paper. There are assertions and also informal arguments about intuition. I don't intend to cover those. Having a presentation, having someone kind of talk you through these things is usually not the most effective way to study proofs of correctness protocols. Sorry, correctness proofs of protocols. I'm also only going to talk in a cursory way about the recovery protocol, which is very interesting, and the way that they can do recovery while a configuration change is happening is very interesting, but it's just very nuanced and very detailed, and I don't think it would do any of us a lot of good for me to talk all the way through it. I just want to set expectations, and let's get back to, where was I? Memory is still slow. Memory is still going to be slow. And here we are, FARM. Right. So there are two papers in FARM that I think are relevant. There's the one I've highlighted, which is the No Compromises paper, and I think you can read it standalone. But if you want a little bit more information about what they're really doing and how some of the RDMA stuff really fits together, the Fast Remote Memory paper is Network Systems Design and Implementation in 2014 is very good and very, very readable. That's the other thing I like about these papers as well. They're actually readable, although they're dense. They're not written by someone who hates their readers. It's actually good for me to provide these links. Reason being is that if you search for Microsoft FARM, as I did several times in the construction of this talk, did anybody... Anybody know that there was a farming simulator available? I know it's been updated for 2015. I mean no disrespect to farmers, but this was a surprise to me. Katie, did you work on this? Oh, okay. Well, then I'm disappointed. Just that lame Halo thing? Okay, fine. So what do I consider the main contributions of this paper? And this is a subjective judgment. Other people may very much disagree. They build a very low latency, high throughput transactional system. This in itself is an interesting result because it's distributed. And I emphasize very, it really does fly. Like the numbers that they get in the evaluation at the end, which I won't be covering here, but you can certainly look at the pretty graphs yourself, they are really good numbers. And it's very impressive stuff. They also have very, very fast failure detection and recovery. Kind of eye-poppingly so to anybody who's actually implemented failure detection themselves. It's something I have done in Impala, and I have a system that works maybe, 100 times slower than theirs, and I thought, I was doing pretty well. And then I read this paper. They also, to achieve this, they have a fairly unusual distributed system architecture. And this is kind of part of what I mean by challenging the orthodoxy. Not only are they saying, look, you can have all of these performance, consistency, et cetera, guarantees, but do you really have to build systems with Paxos-based state machine replication? Maybe you don't. Maybe there is another way to do it. I once saw a talk by Mike Burrows, who's the guy who wrote Chubby at Google. And he said, and it's a quote that stuck with me, and I believed it at the time, and it's kind of slowly started to fade in its relevance to me. There is one consensus protocol, and Paxos is it. Everything else is broken. I now kind of believe that, you know, variations on the theme of Paxos are interesting and relevant, and actually we're now at the stage in building distributed systems where investigating these alternatives is extremely relevant. The last thing they do is they build a commit protocol that's, you know, Paxos-like but not completely Paxos, which is optimized for the RDMA low message counts context. So that's what I think, you know, if you're going to take four things away from the paper, these are the things I think you could say it does. So what does FARM give you in terms of abstractions? Well, fundamentally, it's really kind of a shared memory abstraction in some sense. Every machine in the cluster, every participant in a FARM cluster has access to a global address space of addressable memory that's partitioned across many machines and replicated. And there are many other systems that have this abstraction. Sinfonia was a good one from SOSP in 2007. I think RamCloud has a similar abstraction. Basically, they're providing distributed, shared, reliable, high-performance memory. To interact with that, rather than just getting, you know, peek and poke effectively, you have a transactional API that says, you know, let's move one step up the stack and start talking about objects. You know, let's start reasoning about objects, mutating them in a transactional context. One thing you get that's really nice is lock-free reads. So there's the ability to just do single object read operations without the possibility of being blocked by some other blocking operation, which is, I think, very cool. The programming model, if you want to run FARM code, you run it on a FARM cluster. The clients can run arbitrary application logic inside each machine. You want to avoid side effects, because if you're treating it transactionally, you've got to behave. FARM can't enforce that for you. So if you launch the missiles stay launched. But the objects themselves are transactionally managed by FARM. And the objects really are just like mappings, like contiguous parts of the address space. When I say an object, I just mean some collection of bytes. This programming model means, the way that they do transactional concurrency control, it's optimistic concurrency control, that leads to a couple of anomalies on read. You may read, you know, inconsistent versions of a single object or of two different objects during your kind of application logic section of the commit protocol. This is apparently, they say in the paper, that you can work around these things automatically, and they may refer to like a hardware STM-based paper, which I did not read. They kind of gloss over it. I'm prepared to believe there's not a particularly big restriction either. Oops, keep pressing the wrong keyboard. So rather than try and reproduce a diagram and do a terrible job of it, here's one of the diagrams from the paper, and this is the system architecture. So machine A, machine B, and machine C are all, you know, equivalent. We've just zoomed into machine A to see its innards, but they're all participants in the FARM cluster. And so you can see application code runs on the FARM CPU, then interacts with FARM via the FARM API. And then there are these in-memory data structures. There's the memory region, which is the actual thing that contains bits and bytes. There's the transactional log, and the transactional log belongs to each peer that might be interacting with it. And then there is the message queue, which is where you queue up things and say, you know, actually, CPU, would you mind taking a look at this? I can't just do this with RDMA. What is unusual about this, so far so good, is like a very symmetric distributed system, very traditional. What is less usual about this, and I don't want to say it's like, you know, they're the first persons ever to have done it, but it's not that typical, is they offload coordination of the configuration management to an external service like ZooKeeper, but only that. And now, why is that interesting? So I worked on ZooKeeper for a long time. A very typical use case for ZooKeeper is to put all of your coordination requirements into it. So you deal with cluster membership, you deal with leases, you deal with failure detection, all that kind of stuff. That belongs in a ZooKeeper cluster, and then you kind of like forget it, and you say, okay, you know, ZooKeeper's handling this right now. it's no great surprise to say the Zookeeper isn't up to the task of the performance requirements that they were placed on that kind of failure detection system. So they just use Zookeeper as a store. They just write what's called the configuration. And the configuration is basically how best to describe it? It's a tuple, as all these data structures are. You ever notice in systems papers, any data structure is a tuple of some sort, containing the set of nodes that exist in a particular configuration. So as machines fail, they'll be evicted from the configuration. The configuration has a monotonically increasing ID, so the most recent configuration is the most up-to-date one with the highest ID. That's the only thing that exists in Zookeeper for farm. Everything else is managed by another kind of off-cluster system, which is represented by machine D, called the configuration manager. So this is the departure from perhaps the traditional Paxos deployment. This is getting towards a variant, which Leslie Lamport covered, called vertical Paxos. And vertical Paxos is so named because there's a visualization which I didn't bother to reproduce, but basically it allows you to change configurations while votes are in progress, effectively. So without wanting to get too far into the details of Paxos, if you're in the process of trying to agree on a particular most recent action, Paxos usually requires you to finish that vote before you affect a configuration change. Vertical Paxos is a variant that allows you to actually change the configuration during a vote, and that actually allows for the faster recovery protocol, which is kind of the last non-evaluation section of the paper. Yeah. No, because Paxos is the hardest algorithm. So it's kind of Paxos complete in the sense. I would say vertical Paxos is probably You've kind of nudged me onto a bugbear of mine. I think people who repeat to you that Paxos is incredibly hard to implement are not helping. Paxos is not that hard to implement. It's hard to get perfectly right and highly tuned for production deployment. But what isn't? Paxos suffers from the fact that Leslie Lamport is way smarter than you, and he's way smarter than me. And he writes papers unaware of this fact. And so you have Paxos Made Simple, which is anything but. You have the Part-Time Parliament, which is, I don't know what he did on his holidays, I'm not entirely sure. The pedagogy, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, is poor in the case of Paxos. And I don't know, some of you may have read the webpage that I once wrote, 6 or 7 years ago, about how Paxos is actually works, and I tried to keep it simple. And what's really been gratifying since then is there have been a number of efforts of people to actually just simplify this thing. Raft is a really good example, but also Paxos itself is a knowable, understandable thing. So don't be scared of Paxos. But vertical Paxos is Paxos plus some. So actually, I was being too glib. It probably is technically strictly harder to implement, but it's also a reasonably understandable thing. There's a great website, I think it's from CMU. There's this really cool trend recently of having graduate students build websites to explain their work. I think it's wonderful. Berkeley do an amazing job of this, but CMU now have this Paxos Made Moderately Complex. Fine, I guess we're stuck with that kind of titling, but it does a really good job of saying this is what's different about the different Paxos protocols, and this is why this one's interesting, and this is what we should do, and it has diagrams, and that's great. So I encourage you all to kind of look that up. So one of the real advantages of vertical Paxos, and we'll touch a bit on this later, is it allows the cluster to be split into read and write quorums, which is a very if you're familiar with Cassandra and Dynamo and how they do read and write, this is kind of a similar thing. Rather than say, I have to write to a strict majority, you can say in vertical Paxos, let's actually, we'll write to every machine that's a replica, and we'll read from only one of them, which is, overlapping quorums, and that works particularly well. And this is a deployment architecture that they leverage
I forget which way you pronounce some words in English and in American sometimes, how you leverage, that was deliberately English, the performance benefits of only having to read from a single note. So this is actually, you know, them moving to this protocol and then, you know, creating a variant on it is not just by chance. They've really thought this through. So let's talk about how addressable memory comes to be inside a farm cluster. So memory is partitioned into 2 gigabyte regions. I don't know how they chose 2 gigabytes. The assumption of the farm work, by the way, is that all of your data exists in memory. Really, apart from the SSDs to kind of back up your memory if the UPS should fail, they don't use disk at all. And so they kind of say, look, RAM's getting cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. You got 192 gigabytes often in your machines. They run tests on 90 machine clusters. That's a lot of memory. You know, medium-sized data will fit very nicely into this sort of thing. And I think that's actually not a completely unreasonable assumption. So each machine can expose a 2 gigabyte region. As I said before, regions are served by a single primary. That's while a primary exists, and it always exists, this is one of the kind of invariants of the protocol, that is the machine that gets read from. But of course, because you don't hit CPU on read, you're not really running such a high risk of a bottleneck or like a hotspot in your cluster. The region to primary mapping, i.e. like who do I go talk to read from a particular region, is maintained by the configuration manager, which is the kind of the separate membership management system that I pointed out earlier, the machine D, I think, in that diagram. And just as an aside, if you've got a workload that you know, co-location, maybe you're going to join two tables together, and it's particularly useful to have regions be on the same machine so they don't even have to go across the network, you can tell Farm to do that. You can say, like, region A, B, C, and D should all be on this one machine. Otherwise, the configuration manager will do its best to load balance amongst the available machines. And it does that when a region is actually created, and a region is created at an individual machine's behest. They're a little wishy-washy, I think, in the paper on what should trigger that, actually what triggers a machine to say, hey, I need more memory. Maybe it's all pre-allocated up front. Maybe it's completely application controlled. It's not totally clear to me. there's a two-phase commit protocol, which happens. The configuration manager contacts every replica, so the single primary and the F backups. And by the way, every time I use F in this paper, it's kind of a very common shorthand. That's the number of failures that we're prepared to tolerate before a particular region goes unavailable. It's the same as the F in the 2F plus 1 when you're talking about how many machines in Paxos you need to withstand F failures. Whenever you see F in a distributed systems paper, that's usually what it means. This two-phase commit ensures that all replicas have the mapping before it gets used. This is kind of an obvious requirement, but it makes sense that you never have an inconsistent state. This is why you don't just kind of lazily instantiate regions on individual machines, because you could have a failure while you are creating regions, and that would leave you with some of the replicas having a region, some of the replicas not, and that's obviously a terrible state to get into. So this is why we use a commit protocol at this point. This is just a small detail in the paper. This is slightly speculative. I couldn't find the right answer to what happens if you need to recover the region mapping when the configuration manager fails, but I may have just missed it. But my guess is that the state of mappings of machines to regions is present in the cluster. The machines that are alive know which regions are mapped to them, and they also may have some of these mappings cached because they cache the mappings when they ask the configuration manager for the place to get a particular region. So my guess is if there's failover from the configuration manager, it pulls in the region mappings from the machines as part of the recovery process. If anybody did read the paper and found the answer to that question, feel free to correct me. Okay, transactional protocol. Let's talk about how you actually operate. And this is kind of interesting. It uses optimistic concurrency. Now, the difference between optimistic concurrency and pessimistic concurrency is
in my understanding, really what can happen when you lock. So when you do a concurrency protocol, think about what you might have to do. Well, okay, you have to make the updates to the things you want to mutate. Okay, you have to do that at some point. You have to tell everybody else not to mutate them while you are doing so, and that's the act of taking locks. And optimistic concurrency usually says, well, we'll take the locks and then we'll try and do the work, and if it doesn't work, we'll roll back. But we can roll back after the locks are taken. You know, the act of locking something can effectively fail. Pessimistic concurrency is says, I don't believe that no one else is going to mutate this stuff while I'm mutating it, so I'm going to take locks before I even try and do anything. Optimistic concurrency is usually better for low conflict systems. If you have transactions that you think are going to conflict, you have a very high rate of rollback. It doesn't work terribly well. It's not totally clear to me why they chose optimistic concurrency for this system, except it seems to fit very well with their commit protocols. Talking of commit protocols, I just love this tweet. If you haven't seen it before, it's just perfect. And it's actually not inaccurate, which I like very much. read it, internalize it, and when you're all ready, we'll move on to the actual commit protocol. So here is a diagram, and again, it does a better job than I could do with like bullet points and worse diagrams of explaining the commit protocol. But let's talk about what's going on here. When I want to do something, I have two distinct phases as an application thread that said, okay, now is the time for me to, I don't know, update the sales ledger or delete that player from the database or something. The first is the execute phase, and this is where we're optimistic. We say, okay, let's try and make our changes. So they, presumably on a copy of the data, they communicate to a number of primaries via RDMA. So these are all RDMA communications here. The dashed lines are for RDMA reads, and where you've got a little blacked out rectangle, that says the actual object data is being sent over the network. So these are kind of the more heavyweight communications. So in the first phase, we actually just communicate to the primary and read all the objects that we want to interact with in our protocol, sorry, in our transaction. And then, we update them. We read, the current value of the sales ledger, or we read, the gamer ID for a particular guy who's, swearing at everybody on Halo, so we have to, kick him out of the system. And then we want to do something with him. And that happens kind of at the point of that dotted vertical line. If we want to mutate them, this is where it happens. It's not shown on here because it's just a communication diagram. Once we've made the changes, then we actually try and lock, and this is the optimistic thing. Pessimistic concurrency would have us locking these objects beforehand. Optimistic concurrency has us locking after we've speculatively tried to read and make the changes. The lock sounds very lightweight. Actually, what it is, the lock message sends the entire copy of all changed objects to the primaries that are responsible for them. And what's responded to with that solid line, which is a response to an RDMA write, is the version number of the object. And every object, I should have mentioned, has this version number, which allows you to detect whether or not someone else changed it while you were doing your execute phase. And if someone did, well, sorry, you have a conflict, let's just back out, raise an error to the application, the application's most likely to retry. Otherwise, if everything is fine, the object version numbers haven't changed, what do? Well, we do this validation step, which is, I've slightly conflated two steps. Validation is where the final read and check is done. So we do the write in the lock phase, we do the read and validation of the object ID in the validate phase, and then we can commit. So this is, almost kind of a canonical, two-phase commit kind of approach. Think of lock as kind of like a prepare. Validate doesn't really exist in two-phase commit. And then we commit. So the first thing we do is commit to the backups. And that's because I presume we don't want to kind of actually publish our results to the primary, but not the backups, and have a situation where people could actually read the data. Then the primary fails and the backups don't know about it. So we write to the backups first.
once we've written the backups, we can commit to the primary. The primary effectively publishes the results of our changes. And it's at that point that we, as you say, you see that line says report committed to app. That's the point at which we can actually say to our application, your transaction was successful, congratulations. Otherwise, if we were to do it before that, we could wind up with clients reading state that really wasn't durable, and transactions may kind of come and go, which would be very, very problematic for consistency. After that, we have this fifth phase, which is truncate. That's really just about management of the in-memory log. All through these phases, these writes have been going to this this log data structure, which is, as we saw, maintained kind of on the RDMA interface. And truncate just says, okay, you don't actually need to keep a record of everything that happened before this transaction, because by dint of like strict serialization, we know that everything before has been committed, so just forget about it. Like, remove your rollback logs and all that kind of stuff, we're good. So a couple of notes on the commit protocol. You notice that all communication is over RDMA, so we're going to be saving a lot of CPU. I confused myself on the slide. So the total number of message delays is, I believe, not faster than packets. And when I mean a message delay, I mean like how many phases effectively do we have to go through? What's the critical path? How long does that take in our commit protocol? That may not be faster than Paxos. Paxos actually has a provable lower bound on the number of message delays you have to go through to achieve consensus. But the total number of messages in this case is actually better. And you can take my word for it because I took the paper's word for it, but here are your equations. On the left-hand side, Paxos sends 4p into 2f plus 1 messages, which is actually not a small amount, particularly if you've got a lot of participants. P is the number of effectively participants in a protocol. On the right-hand side, you've got the farm protocol, where PW, sorry, I couldn't do super subscripts on this, but PW is the number of machines in the write cluster, which is effectively F plus 1, I think. And PR is the number of machines in the read cluster, which is the size of the read quorum, I suppose, which is just 1, because we're just reading from the primary. And some of these messages, in fact, the vast majority of these messages relative to RPC, are extremely cheap because it's all over RDMA. So this is actually a really efficient protocol. What is what was kind of interesting, though, to note one of those engineering-y things was that at some point they actually fail back to RPC. They say, if we're reading at some phase in the algorithm more than some thresholded number of objects at one time, it's actually cheaper to do an RPC because, it shouldn't be a surprise that this threshold exists, because for every RDMA read you have to do, for every object you want to access, you have to do one RDMA read. But the threshold is surprisingly low. If they access more than 4 objects in a single read set of a single transaction, then they actually say, well, the overhead of an RPC is actually worth paying now rather than doing 4 RDMA reads. So I found that curious, surprisingly low, but there you are. So moving on from the transaction protocol, failure detection and recovery, which I think is very interesting, and kind of an underappreciated, understudied part of distributed systems, terribly important. Failure detection and recovery is mediated by leases, i.e., if you want some node to know that you're not going to be, to know your failure state, you register with it and say, like, here's a lease. I'm taking out a lease on our connection. And then they send keep alives. There's a three-way handshake to say, would you like a lease? Yes, I'd like a lease. Have we both got a lease? Yes, that's terrific, kind of thing. It's a very chatty protocol, but it means that a lease is established on both ends of the connection. This thing in purple, I think, is absolutely mind-boggling. Their leases are only 5 milliseconds long for a 90-node cluster, so they can do failure detection with very low false positive rate over 90 nodes in under 5 milliseconds. And the leases are refreshed every millisecond. So every machine in the cluster is refreshing its lease every millisecond with the configuration manager, and they get a low false positive rate. Because that's the trade-off you have when you do failure detection. You can make the period of detection very, very low, But then that leads to, you know, noise. Hey, like a garbage collection event happened, and then, you know, surprise, surprise, you think I'm dead. Because the CPU isn't involved on, you know, at least one end of the lease, I believe, they can do, you know, they can do this in 1 millisecond. I was really, really surprised by that. And this is where some of the engineering comes in. How they actually achieved this was, you know, apart from having the fundamental primitives of RDMA, which is interesting, they keep the lease manager memory pre-allocated up front. They pin the code in RAM, which is interesting. So they actually are worried about the code pages being paged out. They keep hardware threads free, but what's interesting is they don't pin the lease manager threads to the hardware threads, because they found that they would always be preempted by something. There would always be a really high priority Windows, because this is actually all built on Windows, a high priority Windows thread that would take the hardware thread to which they were pinned, and then they actually would have lower latency than if they were available to be pinned on, or available to be executed on any one of the available hardware threads. They also use an unreliable transport, i.e. kind of a UDP-alike over RDMA. Presumably, it's not that unreliable because they're able to do this, like, you know, really excessively low latency failure detection. So I thought that was very cool. And then when a lease fails, we have this 7-step process towards recovery. How does the system actually manage failure? The first thing that happens is the configuration manager, which is the thing that holds these leases across the whole cluster. It's just a single machine. It'll start turning off external requests. OK, so I think you failed. I think the system is unhealthy. Let's stop everybody from executing requests. That itself is kind of interesting because they back their performance, they back their failure recovery time so much that they don't try and do any particular clever engineering to allow some requests to continue to allow new requests to be executed. They just block everything. Then this is a nice step. They check for correlated failures. So clearly they're worried about an entire rack going down, so they ping every machine in the rack, and that allows them to kind of amortize the cost of a huge correlated failure. Then what they do is they say, okay, you guys are dead, fine, see ya. And they update this configuration object, which is stored in ZooKeeper. And they use ZooKeeper's sequential ID facility to move the number of the configuration ID atomically forward, and that stops there being conflicts with other configuration managers that may also be starting doing the same thing. Then the configuration manager remaps the region. So it actually says, okay, well, you know, the primary for this region failed, and one of the backups for this region failed. Who's gonna take him over? It does the load balancing. It probably tries to deal with the hints that you gave it about co-location. And this all happens kind of on the configuration manager, which is the thing responsible for managing kind of membership. And then the other 3 steps happen with the participation of other nodes in the cluster. So we send the replicas a new configuration. This is effectively kind of another two-phase commit protocol. They spring up everywhere. You apply the new configuration to the replicas, they wait for, replicas are still not accepting requests, then you commit the new configuration and the replicas are told to start serving requests again. And then we move forward. The reason they do this is kind of interesting, and the reasoning is a little bit subtle. This ensures that the membership status is consistent across the entire cluster at all times. And the reason they said they had to do it this way was because a very typical way to make sure that leases are consistently observed is to have the node that is maintaining a lease check on every request to make sure it's still the lease owner. Because the worst thing that could happen is, you know, I failed, but I don't know about it. I think I still have some leases. You ask me for some data. I say, hey, that's great. Here's the data. And actually, their system has moved on. What I could do is I could say, you know, say the stool is the configuration manager. Hey, stool. You know, is my lease still active? And I can do that kind of efficiently because I have this RDMA thing, which is terribly efficient. So why not do that? And the reason is because if someone is reading data from me, I cannot interpose the CPU. This is kind of one of the interesting things they have to engineer around with RDMA. I cannot actually execute any CPU code at any point. So I can't do this check because no one's telling me that I should do. So instead, they have to engineer it in such a way that they get a commit protocol that informs me of my eviction from the cluster and informs everyone else, more to the point, of my eviction from the cluster before the system is moved on. And again, because they have this low latency messaging, it's actually not a terribly expensive step. Now, this is the slide I'm sort of going to gloss over. Okay, it is the last slide, you'll be glad to know. That is almost the totality of what I'm going to say about this. Transaction recovery is very complicated and nuanced and interesting, so I encourage you to read that part of the paper and explain it to me. Effectively, the nice nuance here is that in-flight transactions, when there's a failure, can be continued. And this is... By my understanding, this is a consequence of this vertical Paxos, a like protocol that they're using. They allow configurations to change while an update is in flight. This is actually a really hard problem to reason about. Design of these protocols is difficult. In Zookeeper, we struggled with this for a long time. It took like a really brilliant engineer, an academic from Yahoo Research, to really push forward configuration changes in Zookeeper, because it's very complicated to know, okay, if this set of nodes has changed, who are the nodes I need to contact to commit this change? It's very meta. It's like, you know, commit protocol, commit thyself, and it's a very hard thing to reason about. So I don't have time. I've talked enough to go into the details of this. The really nitty-gritty details aren't necessarily super illuminating, but the fact that they can have this property, I think, is very, very cool. And that is everything. Thank you very much for your indulgence and your patience. If you have questions, ask me now or ask me afterwards. Thank you. That microphone is very heavy. A lighter one? Do any of you have questions as well?
Unreliable.
Yes.
This one's good.
Okay, so since we're in a new venue, I'm trying to figure out microphones. This one says it's unreliable, so that's great. So if anybody has any questions, then I can go with the microphone. Gil.
Hey. Hello. Thanks for the talk.
You're
I have what's hopefully a little bit simpler of a question. So earlier on in the talk, you mentioned this sort of, I'll call it a global address space abstraction for the distributed system. And I'm just curious, from a very basic level, like, why do we want to do that instead of having MPI or some message-based notion of how you deal with all the machines and you have this clearly partitioned address space?
That's a great question. And I don't think they do a terrific job of motivating it in the paper, but I have read other papers that try and push this forward a little bit. And one thing is, we're all used to addressing memory. Like, we do it every day. If you're a C++ programmer, it's like 99% of your job is to figure out if you're reading the right bytes. And so it's a very familiar abstraction. Now, they don't try and go the whole way, I believe, with this and say, you know, here is a completely virtualized address space that just happens to be replicated across nodes. But it still allows us to efficiently implement a kind of an object model agnostic global storage thing. And that means that you can layer on top of it whatever you like. You know, when you start to talk about using message passing protocols and so on, you kind of have to start talking about like what are my nouns? This system kind of delays that requirement to me. I know that's a very vague answer, but I don't think it's actually got a kind of a, you know, this is a big win. From an engineering standpoint, you can't do this RDMA thing without an address space. They go hand in hand. So if that's the tail wagging the dog, I'd also believe that. If they want to say, look, we believe that address spaces are useful, and as it so happens, here is an incredibly efficient way we have of implementing that, I'd be fine with that as a justification as well. It doesn't always have to start with us saying, let's start with address spaces and see if, and firstly justify that they are the best, and then do the best thing with them. We can also say, look, here's a really efficient thing. Address spaces work. That's great. But it's a great question.
You said that they fall back to RPC after, you know, four objects or whatever. Yeah. What object sizes are you talking about in this?
I actually don't know. My reading of that section in the paper is that they're talking about the overhead of performing the RDMA read. Mm-hmm. And it's that actually adds up to one RPC. So less the amount of transmitted data, which is, you know, it's going to be the same pretty much whether it's an RPC or an RDMA read in mm-hmm. total, and instead kind of amortizing the cost of you know, the communication mechanism.
Okay, that makes sense.
Do you know of like any research around RDMA and like versioning concerns? Because obviously, if I'm directly reading memory from another machine and then I roll and upgrade through the cluster, I've pretty much destroyed all of my data. Or I could, right?
What would you upgrade?
I mean, like if I'm writing to memory and I change the format that I'm writing to memory, and like one has an additional field that the other one doesn't because the versions are incompatible. Like Protobuf gives you this idea of. Mm-hmm. Like, I incur that serialization cost because I, like, now have this version-tolerant thing that I can send throughout the cluster. I know it's, like, not the problem this paper's solving. I just didn't know if there was, like, anything out there on this yet because it's fairly new.
Not to my knowledge. I mean, it is a great point. Like, the observation that serialization buys you more than just the ability to speak to a wire. I would think there would be more lightweight ways of doing the versioning that don't rely on the ability to kind of, as I say, translate like addresses and offsets, which is what we talk about when we talk about memory, into, you know, self-contained, self-describing, you know, version data structures. It's probably a middle ground, but that would be interesting to understand.
Hey, what about can I just use RDMA, like get to work tomorrow?
Do you have a computer?
Yes.
No, probably not. Oh, I love that you just accepted that as my answer. But the reason being, from my understanding, and we're starting to wade into kind of the very swampy ground of like network administrators here, is that it requires support from switches. It requires support from the network hardware to actually implement and deploy. So it's not something you just turn on immediately. And it's, in my understanding, very unlikely that your network, I don't know where you work, maybe you work at like, you know, Microsoft Research, in which case, yes. But otherwise, it seems unlikely. I'm not too familiar with... I couldn't speak authoritatively on like how likely your network switches are to support this. The paper kind of hand-wavingly says, oh, yeah, it's coming. It's, you know, it's cheap. And then I read some Wikipedia articles, which are also very authoritative, of course, that said, you know, this may not be the case. So, interesting question. Don't know the answer.
So... what's the maximum physical distance those machines can have? I mean, you talk about 90 machines, but aren't one availability zone, one rack, one data center, can they be, how far can they be away from each other?
That's a really good question. So what I do know is that there's two versions of RDMA. The first version is you can only speak to other machines on the same Ethernet domain. So that naturally tells you like how far away your machine can be. Is there a switch? Yes, then you can't talk beyond it. But RDMA version 2, which I'm pretty sure is what we're talking about here, is an IP layer protocol. So it's routable. So that means that actually, you know, switches can forward it. So now we're talking not about, you know, physical possibilities, but actually how do the latencies change if I'm actually talking about cross-data center communication? This 5 millisecond bound, you know, I'm still blown away by it, but I bet it's not achievable if I'm talking like from, you know, US East to US West. Probably speed of light tells you that, actually, if you think about it. therefore, as a result, I don't think the protocol is impractical at those kind of distances. I don't know of an upper bound being placed upon it, but it may the latencies may start to converge to what's already achievable, and that might be a different set of trade-offs.
So one of the ways that you framed this paper was sort of the history of databases.
Yes.
And there were two sort of factors in that. There was like, hey, we've got all these constraints, but there were also, hey, we want to do these different workloads. And they're obviously somewhat linked, but I'm kind of curious if you sort of wipe the slate of assumptions clean, instead of going, hey, look, like HP said, oh, look, mem resistors are right around the corner. We're going to do all this great stuff. It'll be a fantastic. Yeah,
how are you all enjoying your mem resistor-based computers, by the way?
Right, exactly. So, but what if we wiped the slate clean and sort of pushed it from the other direction and said, okay, like if we sort of throw away some of these assumptions and we look at our workloads and we look at the things that would be ideal to deal with these workloads, can we please have that hardware? What do you think that looks like?
I am profoundly underqualified to answer that kind of question. My guess is that actually we do let the workloads drive things a little bit, but we have a very simplistic way of looking at workloads, and it's typically, are you doing analytic processing or are you doing transactional processing? This is a transactional processing paper. This is, you know, OLTP. Analytical processing changes the requirements a little bit, usually because the amount of data involved is much larger, not just because the base data sets are bigger, but because you're doing big joins, and you're materializing more intermediate data, and you need memory for other things than just actually storing your tables. Transactional data is a bit different. You tend not to, you don't always create new data with every transaction, although you very often do. I'd like to say I have a great answer for you, you know, and here's what we're missing from my particular workload. I do think the existing systems research does a reasonably good job of hewing towards practical, for some value of practicality. There's another great rant to be gone on about like what we have assumed is realistic workloads. But I don't think it's the case that when they're doing these clean slate designs that they actually say, they're actually workload independent. I think that's one of the input parameters that they start off with because they have characteristics. I think it's actually necessary in some sense because if they don't do it, they are going to get bad performance. That's the easiest way because they don't know what they're actually building a system to do. I know that's not quite answered your question, but it's the best I could do.
So they use optimistic concurrency control. Do they describe in the paper how they avoid starvation of a process from committing a transaction? Do they have any kind of mechanism to actually say, this process has been denied too many transactions, it should take over another transaction or something?
That's a great question. I didn't see it in the paper. I would expect there's some kind of orthogonal optimistic concurrency control work on this issue. I don't expect it to necessarily be a process-specific thing, more a target region-specific thing. But you can take the view and say, look, I am a database. I'm agnostic to who gets committed just as long as some people get committed. And I would expect that actual liveness, which is a very desirable goal, is not an explicit goal of this paper. So the answer is no, they probably don't even address it.
I have one comment and one question. The comment is that actually RDMA, you require all the devices on the routes to implement that, to support that, because they have to get the feedback signals, say that, I'm too busy, you have to slow down, because you cannot afford any peggy loads.
That's really fascinating. Thank you for letting us know. Is that even for kind of RDMA over TCP?
No. This is the original RDMA.
Okay, so if you were doing a line of like data center to data center, you could, bridge it with RDMA over TCP between data centers, and then so you don't have to have like the intermediate routes like across the Atlantic be able to talk RDMA.
That's correct, but I don't know much about over TCP stuff. Okay. But within the data center, because you know all the devices, on the NIC actually it has a lot of driver update to deal with this condition.
Okay, that's really interesting. Thank you.
My question is, if a CPU is the bottleneck, why not just add a GPU there?
Okay. this is almost the Harris is better than Hadoop question. What makes you, my retort to that question is generally, what makes you think that the GPU is like a particularly useful tool for this? I can see some workloads that say, deep pipelining might make sense, which is a strength of GPUs. They're doing like fixed parallel instruction processing, so maybe that makes some sense. But I don't yet have evidence that GPUs can actually handle this kind of workload particularly well, because they need to do random access to memory, which last time I looked wasn't a great strength of theirs. But if someone knows better, feel free to correct me.
There was a paper at hpts.ws last year on somebody running databases inside GPUs using the SIMD architecture to do ridiculously fast scans and stuff.
I saw that. Was that a distributed database? This is the workload we're trying to offload. I mean, I absolutely think there's a place in database processing for GPUs because they do have this really nice you know, just let's just stream it through, like topology, I guess, to their execution plans. But the distributed aspect is has a different shape to it. That's what I'm not sure GPUs necessarily fit.
Hi, sorry, I don't know if
there you are. Okay, good. Sorry, yeah. I had no idea where you are.
I was curious if you've thought about or if the paper thought about thinking about the distributed memory space as another layer of cache and thinking about intelligently bringing the data closer to where it's needed, if the question makes sense.
It absolutely makes sense. My guess is that they do some kind of locality. As I said, there's some locality hints, and also I think there's a sense in which you can send work to the machine that has the data, which is, you know, useful. But I also think they probably take the view that, like, hey, these reads are really, really fast. They're not as fast as main memory access, nowhere near, but they are really, really fast. So let's introduce caching when we know that that is the bottleneck, like the lack of locality is the problem.
Right. So you flag me. We're going to go to the last question, and after that, we're going to go to Mars Bar that is like half a block away, so beer is going to flow. So.
Hooray.
So in the paper, there's a bunch of stuff about using the power units to be able to back up everything to the SSD, but the recovery protocol pretty much tells you that every new region that has to be reloaded has to be zeroed in memory and copied from the peer. So why do you need to store stuff in SSDs?
So my understanding was the whole service restarts. You know, where are you going to recover your data from? That's really what I think durability, which is what it provides, gives you. Yes, if you have kind of an incremental failure, then you can't recover your old version of the data unless someone gives you the transaction log and replays it, which you could do, but actually it's just cheaper to do a bulk copy. But if you have a, you know, say all F plus one of your machines fail for some reason, there's a complete data center outage, there's a major network partition or something like that, and you just got unlucky, then where are you going to recover your data from there?
All right, so before we go to the bar, if you have something that belongs in a trash can, please pick it up with you on the way out. And I would like to thank Heroku for hosting us and Henry for the great presentation. So let's give it up for Henry. Woo! And we're going to Mars Bar. So if you leave and go to the left, it should be like on the corner right in front. Like, it should be really close.